Welcome to Bedford Free Public Library's Winter Lecture Series. I am Richard Callaghan. I'm a library director. I know a lot of you are here. Thank you for coming. Thank you for understanding about the chair situation. We are at capacity. We cannot put any more chairs out. I'm sorry. Unless we want to build a new meeting room. So. But I appreciate you understanding that. Two things I just announced before our favorite professor takes over. These lectures are sponsored by the Friends of the Bedford Free Public Library. Without them, we could not do any of this, or are the programs like the Chinese New Year program we had yesterday for the kids, any of those programs without the Friends. Their hard work is what makes this possible. So I want to thank the Friends, and I want to thank our volunteers for providing all the goodies. And there are pamphlets up in front of near where the food is for joining the Friends. It's a great organization. They could always use more help. And the Friends book sale is coming up the first week in April, I believe. Yeah. That's always a big fundraiser for us, for the Friends. So if you come to that or help out, that would be great. So we really appreciate it. Second thing is, next week is President's Day weekend. We are not meeting on President's Day weekend. Taking that weekend off. And we will resume in 2 weeks.
Yes.
And I've been reminded, thank you, John, if people please turn your cell phones off or mute them, please, that would be great. And this back door is, I always try to have that open if people want to come in that way, too. I think that's it, Dan.
And I guess so.
And if most people, you know Dan, but Dan, Professor Dan Breen from Brandeis University, our favorite lecturer.
Thank you. Well, thank you.
I think we're going to go back to the format we usually do. Last week we didn't have a break because it was Super Bowl Sunday and all that kind of stuff. So we will have a break after the lecture and then come back for questions.
Okay.
All right.
Well, it's a very nice, as always, to be here and for you to be kind enough to hug me here. And you're my favorite audience. You're a very impressive group. Now, for example, who would know that one of you, I don't know where he is now, he could raise his hand if he wants to. Remember in my first lecture, those of you who were here, I talked about how it's never a good idea to have a general with gout at the head of your army, especially if you're going at an enemy country. And somebody's actually written two articles about this very topic, rheumatic disease in wartime. So if he's here, there he is back there. So that's really cool. I'm really looking forward to reading these. So thank you for bringing these up in rheumatology retrospective, that journal. Anybody else who wants to read these, you can see those articles. Now today, we will be talking about the, as you can see here, the Modoc War of 1872-1873. But our story begins long before that, if you can go to the first slide. About a million years ago, as a matter of fact, during the Pleistocene era, I don't want to block you guys, so you can see the screen too. And it was back then, during the Pleistocene, that a vast, huge volcano in the northern part of California, a bit to the northeast of Mount Shasta, began a long series of near constant eruptions. There was no huge eruption after a while, but there were a long series of small eruptions, more or less continuous, that gave rise to a basaltic lava flow that eventually formed a strange and beautiful landscape for many, many miles to the north of that mountain, Medicine Lake Mountain. And eventually that landscape would become known in our time as the Lava Beds National Monument. And part of the landscape can be seen in this picture. As you can see, some of where that lava went formed big plains of lava, but some of it formed caves and fissures and crevasses like this. And those kinds of fissures are going to play a very large role in the story to come. Now, if we can go to the next slide, we'll see that about here in this lake is where the lava flow stopped. The lava flow stopped about a few miles to the south of this lake. This is Tule Lake in Northern California, almost at the Oregon border, as a matter of fact. And as you can see, it's a very shallow lake, but don't let that deceive you, because in the time we're talking about, it was broader and much deeper. And it was along this lake, especially to the north, where the Lost River flows into Tule Lake, from Oregon into Northern California. That was the homeland of the Modoc Indians, and they're the ones we're going to be talking about today. Their ancestors had moved to that landscape along the Lost River to the north of Tule Lake and the lava beds to the south of Tule Lake, probably 5,000 or 6,000 years ago. At least that long, there had been people living there, and they were probably the ancestors of the modern Modoc Indians. And in fact, the word Modoc is simply their word for Tule Lake. They'd been living there time immemorial, and they had arranged to have a very good life for themselves along Tule Lake, and especially along the Lost River that goes into Tule Lake. There were maybe 2,000 of them at any given time. That would be the average stable population of Modocs around Tule Lake. And they would live by fishing in the Lost River. There was ample trout, plenty of trout to go around for that small a population. And they would also live on pounding out flour using seeds from water lilies that they would find in Tule Lake. Very, very ample food supply. And why not? There were no oak trees around there. So unlike some of the native peoples of the West, they couldn't depend upon pounding out acorn flour for their livelihood. So they used the seeds of the water lily plant. And also, they would hunt it in the mountains, and they would live a seasonal kind of lifestyle where during the winter, when it got very cold and there was a lot of snow in the vicinity, what they would do to secure themselves in the winter is dig about 4 feet into the ground and dig these big squares, maybe about 20 feet by 20 feet, and there they would line the new holes in the ground with bark, grass, whatever was needed to make it snug, and then they would build it up with logs on top, cover it over with whatever they could find, also bark and other logs, and they would live a very snug winter until it was time for the spring and it was time for the fish to return and to time to begin the seasonal cycle that had always supported them. And that's the way it had been for thousands of years for the Modocs and their kindred people, the Klamath Indians, a little bit to the north. About the time we're talking about, the 18th century, when the first white trappers appeared in the neighborhood, the Modocs and the Klamaths, which again were cousins, kindred peoples, had more or less split apart, and they were living separate identities and separate lives. The Klamaths a bit to the north, and the Modocs still around Lost River and Tule Lake. The trappers arrived, as I said, the late 18th century, but it didn't really disturb their lifestyles too much. It was only in the early 19th century, with the opening of the Oregon Trail, that white settlers began to appear in that neighborhood in great numbers. And once they appeared, that was going to be trouble for the Modoc Indians, because they wanted to settle, build farms, and they especially liked the Lost River Valley, a very fertile place, which of course was the Modoc homeland. As a rule, the whites who now began to move in by the 1840s in 1850s, both in Oregon and Northern California, looked down on the Modoc Indians. And one reason they looked down on them was that the Modocs lived partially by digging roots from the ground, the Ipos root, very plentiful and a very good food supply. But whites in general, for no good reason, looked down on Indians who would live on roots from the ground partially. They called them the digger Indians. You might have heard that term, the digger Indians of California. And as a consequence, they didn't have the respect for these Indians that at least some whites did for the horse-bined Comanches and the Cheyennes and the Sioux. They felt as if they were simply in the way and needed to go. And quite clearly and quite intentionally, soon after achieving statehood in 1850, the state of California decided to embark upon a war of extermination against the Modoc Indians. And now we can go to the next slide. That's Tule Lake. And to give you some idea of the geography, there's the lava beds here. The Modocs especially lived up here where the Lost River goes on the north side. But a lot of our story is going to take place on the south side where the lava beds are, especially this strange landscape filled with caves and crevasses that would become known as the Stronghold, as you see on the map there. So we'll leave the map up there for a second. As the scene opens in 1851, as a force of California militia began to march north towards the Modoc territory, the extreme northern part of California, to move them out and, sad to say, to kill as many of them as they could. And one of the leaders of that militia, hired by Governor Burnett, with a budget of $500,000 to accomplish this work against the Modoc Indians, was a guy named Ben Wright. And Ben Wright would become famous in the West in the middle of the 19th century. At one point during the campaign, and he was in charge of a very large group of militiamen marching against the Modocs, Ben Wright decided to supposedly have a parley, a conference with the Modocs, supposedly for the purpose of exchanging prisoners. So he asked them to meet him at a certain place at a certain time. Ben Wright in his militia camped here. The MODOKs camped over there. It's a few hundred of the MODOKs. By this time, their numbers had been far reduced by smallpox, but there were still about maybe 1,000 MODOK Indians left. For several days, they talked, Wright in the militia here, the MODOKs over there. And then on the sixth day, of course, with no warning at all, before dawn, Ben Wright left the camp where the militia was, took his revolver out of his pocket, marched through the camp where the MODOKs were sleeping, and began indiscriminately shooting people as they slept, men, women, and children. And as soon as he started opening fire, people from all sides of the camp, having snuck up on the MODOKs, began spraying their encampment with rifle fire. And it was only with great luck that some of the MODOKs were able to get out. Over 50 men, women, and children were killed. Some people think more than that, but 50 is the best decibel we have. It's a horrible thing, especially when you remember, again, that we're talking over 50 dead. This is a population probably of less than 1,000, so you can imagine the impact that would have had. The men who perpetrated this massacre, and it has always been known as Ben Wright's Massacre ever since. The men who perpetrated it were rewarded by the state of California. Ben Wright himself got a nice $700 bonus for doing this. Never again would the MODOKs trust a flag of truce. Not after this. Not after what happened in the 1850s. Now, there's no silver lining to this story, of course, but maybe there's a little bit of poetic justice somewhere, because a little bit later, this is what happened to Ben Wright. He had reduced a woman into what amounted to sexual slavery, as happened too often back then. She was a native woman, and her name was Chetco Jenny. And one day, Ben Wright literally whipped Chetco Jenny through the streets of this Oregon mining town in front of everybody. And she decided that she was going to get revenge on him. So without him knowing it, she found a Shoshone man named Enos who agreed to kill Ben Wright for Chetco Jenny. And Chetco Jenny was there when Enos grabbed an axe, went to Ben Wright was, and put an end to his life. Enos was caught and punished. Chetco Jenny, however, got away. She went into the woods. It was never seen by a white person again. And that was the end of Ben Wright, a murderer by any definition. However, you wouldn't know that if you were living in the late 19th century, back in a place like Philadelphia or Boston or New York, because being sold in those cities was a dime novel all about the exploits of Ben Wright. He was called a Knight of the Frontier, and the person who wrote the biography of him said he was a man who always labored in the cause of humanity. So it has fallen to historians to, in modern times, tell the real story of Ben Wright. And if you want to know more about the MODOK War, people like Ben Wright, this is a really good book on it by a guy named Robert McNally, which I've been able to glean a good bit of information from. McNally's The MODOK War is probably the best source to look at. So that was the 1850s. But the MODOKs, for the time being, managed to hold their own, at least in the Lost River region, until a little bit later, at the end of the 1860s, when President Grant initiated his peace policy that was going to apply to all the native peoples of the West. And the idea of the peace policy was that the Indians would be persuaded to move onto reservations, and the impetus for doing so, and the incentive for agreeing to such a thing, would be that the reservations, for the first time, would be run efficiently and with some humanity, not by the army, not by underpaid corrupt agents, but rather by, in some cases, Christian missionaries or otherwise well-trained people who had the Indians' interests at heart. That was the idea of the peace policy, sometimes known as the Quaker policy, because a lot of the people in charge really were supposed to be clergymen or people associated with Protestant churches. So it was under the peace policy that the MODOKs were moved to a reservation not too far from the Lost River, where they would live among their Klamath cousins. So that was going to be in 1870. And by this time, there's probably 600 or 700 MODOKs, and they did go to the reservation. And it was a fairly sizable reservation. This might have worked out somewhat well, assuming the government kept its side of the bargain. Maybe this was not the worst thing that could have happened, except the MODOKs by then were not getting along terribly well with the Klamaths. And many of the MODOKs wanted their own reservation, and their idea was, why can't we have a reservation by the Lost River, where we've always lived? The answer was there were too many settlers moving into the vicinity, but that was not good enough to convince many of the MODOKs. So the war stemmed from the fact that at the end of 1870, a group of Modocs decided to leave the reservation to the north of the Lost River and move down back to where the Lost River was to try to resume their old style of life. So maybe about 180 of them in mid to late 1870, led by a figure named Kinpoosh, whom Americans or whites called Captain Jack, left the reservation, went back to the Lost River, and settled back in. It was now, of course, the Army's job to drive them back. It was going to take a while to summon the forces. It was going to take a while before settlers really demanded it. But ultimately, as soon as they left the reservation, war was probably inevitable. So now we can go to the next slide. There's Tule Lake again. And this is Kinpoosh, again, whom whites called Captain Jack. And for the rest of my talk, I'll probably refer to him as Captain Jack. But that's what he looked like. So November 1872. That's when the war is going to begin. Captain James Jackson and 35 mounted troopers made their way south from Fort Klamath in Oregon to Northern California to find the Modocs around the Lost River and force them back onto the reservation. By now it was snowing, winter had set in. The small group of soldiers began to approach the camp where many of the Modocs were. They could barely see in front of them, but they could see figures in the snowy mix, and they knew those were probably the Modocs, and the Modocs could see them coming. Well, the war was now about to begin, but nobody opened fire. Nobody apparently wanted to be the first to fire the first shot. So the Army was able to get pretty close, and their commander, Captain Jackson, sent in his lieutenant, one Lieutenant Boutel, and told him, arrest one of the first warriors you see, and maybe that will be a way to persuade the others to negotiate. Maybe we can all persuade them to go back to the reservation. Lieutenant Boutel approached with a small group of escorts, and the first man facing him was a Modoc named Scarface Charlie. That's what the whites called him. His Modoc name was Chick-Chock-Galli-Lulu-Kuala-Ko. Scarface, he was called Scarface Charlie, had a big scar on his cheek. So here they are in the snow. Lieutenant Boutel, a fascinating character himself, always tried to hide the fact that he was of mixed African and European ancestry, because if anybody knew he was half black, many soldiers wouldn't want to take orders from him. So he knew what it was like to play a game, knew what it was like to conceal what he was really about. Here, all he wanted to do was arrest Scarface Charlie, and then maybe the rest could be negotiated with. He pulled out his revolver, he stuck it in the face of Scarface Charlie, and called Scarface Charlie a son of a bitch, which was not a good idea. Scarface Charlie had his own gun. Scarface Charlie answered, "Me no dog, me no afraid of you." In an instant, they opened fire at the same time. They both missed. But that exchange caused general firing, as the other Modocs now knew what was what. Some of them had already armed themselves when Scarface Charlie opened fire. And now there was a general melee, and the Modocs got the best of it. They killed or wounded 8 of Captain Jackson's men in what would go down in history as the Battle of the Lost River, the first battle of the Modoc War. Only one Modoc man was killed, but about the same time, at an adjoining encampment, some Oregon irregular militia had also attacked, and they killed a Modoc woman and her 6-year-old daughter. And those were the first casualties of the Modoc War. And at that, the Army left to regroup, maybe go back, fight another day. But now, the Modocs had a decision to make. Now, Captain Jack, who was one of their leaders, one of their most important leaders, was not actually in the battle. As soon as he heard the firing started, he began putting on his pants to go join the fighting. He got there after it ended. But now they all had a decision to make. What are they going to do now? The Army is not going to leave them alone in the Lost River. Where should they go? And Captain Jack's idea was, there's only one thing to do now. We've got to cross Tule Lake. We've got to go south to where the lava beds begin, in what would go down in history as the stronghold, Captain Jack's stronghold. Now, they called it the Stone House, but it was a series of what we would call caves. Don't picture something like you see in the cartoons, but it's just fissures, crevasses in the ground, caves along those lines. And they were natural defensive fortresses, this part of the lava beds. Very irregular, all sorts of stone formations from which you could fire behind, and nobody could see you firing. They had long gone there in times of danger, and Captain Jack thought, now's the time to go there. We've got to cross the lake. We've got to get to the stronghold. That is the Stone House. There are at least 700 different what we might call caves or fissures in this place. And the great thing about it was there was so much cover that they could actually have a natural rock corral for the 100 cattle they were about to steal, to take down there with them, ultimately. And that, and they could live on that cattle for a long time. There might be a little over 100 Modocs in the stronghold. They'd have cattle, they'd have other food supplies there. They could hold out, like I said, a very long time indeed. The place was about maybe 300 yards wide, about a mile and a half deep. It's pretty big, pretty extensive, and just the place to be if what you want to do is try to hold off the army. So that's where Hungry Jack wanted to go. That's where most of the Modocs went. But the thing about the Modocs were, they were quite a democracy when it came to making big decisions like this. So although most of the Modocs voted to follow Captain Jack immediately across the lake into the stronghold, some of the Modocs decided not to go along with it. And what they decided to do was go around the east part of Tule Lake. And to take revenge for this attack on them by the army, they began killing settlers along the east part of Tule Lake. Not women, not children. They were very proud of the fact that they wouldn't do that. But they did kill 14 men who were settlers along the east side of Tule Lake. And the Modocs who did that were led by a figure named the Curly-Headed Doctor, who was like a shaman to them. So while Captain Jack was going down to the stronghold, some of the Modocs were ravaging some of the settlements on the other part of the lake. And only later on, by December, did they all join forces in the stronghold. But the fact that so many settlers have been killed on the other side of the lake meant that the army couldn't ignore this for very long. There would be very, very sharp calls for revenge against the Modocs, and that meant that very soon the stronghold would be attacked. So now we are in January of 1873. Now we can go to the next slide. And that's about 6 weeks after the Battle of Lost River. And at that point, about 250 soldiers, led by a Colonel Wheaton, began to approach the stronghold to attack it. This is kind of what it looked like. And you can see that it's not going to be an easy place to attack on the southern side of Tule Lake. The Modocs were outnumbered 5-1. It's about maybe about 180 Modocs, but only about 50 warriors. So somewhere between 250 and 300 soldiers were going to attack 50 Modoc warriors at the stronghold. Captain Jack, knowing how outnumbered they were, thought it might be a good idea to negotiate, maybe surrender, maybe make the best of it if need be back at the reservation, although he didn't want to go there any more than anybody else did. But he was outnumbered. Most of the Modocs wanted to fight. They had a vote. Do we fight here? Do we surrender? And the vote was 14 in favor of surrender, led by Captain Jack, 37 in favor of fighting, led by the Curly-Headed Doctor. Curly-Headed Doctor said, the whites will never get through the stronghold. And the night before the battle, it's January 26th now, the Modocs danced their version of the ghost dance, by which they said, we will be impervious to the bullets of the whites, and the souls of those killed by whites will come back and join us again and give us strength. And then they waited for the attack on January 27th that they were fairly sure was about to come. So the sun came up on the 27th. The army began its slow approach to the stronghold. The idea was to attack it from two directions at once. Mostly these were regular soldiers, there was some militia, but they all had in common the fact that as they advanced, they were going over lava beds with very thin sagebrush on top of it, and the further they went, the rockier it got and the more dangerous it got. And to make matters worse for the army, it was very foggy. So as they were approaching, they couldn't see literally any of the Modocs, but the Modocs could see them. And the Modocs had Springfield rifles, just as many of the soldiers did. And all they had to do was wait behind those rocks until the soldiers were within range. And then they opened fire. The women would hand them ammunition. The men would fire the rifles. And pretty soon, soldiers began falling. And they began falling in alarming numbers. They lost 12 dead, many, many more wounded. And the advance was brought to a standstill early in the battle. All the soldiers could do was take what cover they could and fire, but they had no targets to fire at. They couldn't see literally any of the Indians. But they wouldn't go forward because it was too dangerous. At one point, at the height of this impasse, one Major John Green stood up on a rock close to Tule Lake, and he launched at his men who were not going forward what many remember as the most obscenity-laden tirade in the history of the U.S. Army up to that point, which is saying something, if you think about it. It laced with all of the profanities you could think of. Get moving, get moving. And meanwhile, the Modocs are firing at him. They hit him once, so they only lightly wounded him. But very bravely, he stood up on that rock. Let's go. Nobody would go. For his courage, Major Green was awarded the Medal of Honor a little bit later. But it was all to no good. The advance completely petered out. 50 MODOKs had defeated nearly 300 soldiers at the first Battle of the Stronghold, as it's called. Captain Jack still wanted to make peace, but after this victory in January of 1873, the war party was stronger than ever. We can hold out here forever. They can't take the stronghold. That was curly-headed doctor's idea. What followed was one of the most famous incidents of the entire Indian Wars of the West. For months, the MODOKs stayed in the stronghold. They're living off the cattle. They're living off whatever other food they brought with them. The army began to gather strength in front of it, but nobody wanted to attack the stronghold again. Nobody was looking forward to that. By this time, the commander of U.S. forces in the Pacific Northwest had joined Wheaton and the others around the stronghold. Wheaton had fought alongside General Grant against Lee in Virginia. Wheaton said, "That's the strongest formation I've ever seen." Canby thought so too. Canby didn't want to attack either. Canby wanted to talk. And what followed next is because Canby wanted to talk. So you can go to the next slide now that you see what the stronghold looked like. Here is General Canby, General Edward Canby, who, to draw a link with our last topic, last time I saw you, had fought in the Second Seminole War. And in fact, he was one of the ones who led some of the Seminoles to Oklahoma. Good man. Everybody respected his honesty. He had no real vices. Worst thing that anybody ever said about him really was that he smoked too many cigars. That's about it. If he had any, maybe you wouldn't even call it a bad point, but if there's any unfortunate thing about him from a military perspective, it probably was he had a tendency to move kind of slow. He's rather cautious. And at the end of the Civil War, he absolutely drove Grant to the brink of insanity because it took Canby so long to take Mobile, Alabama. He just kept delaying until everything was ready. Everything had to be ready. And at one point, he drove Grant beyond the precipice of fury when he wrote to Grant, "I need more material to build railroads down here." And Grant wrote him back, "You should be destroying railroads. What are you doing building railroads in Alabama? You should be destroying them. Take Mobile. Stop bothering me." Now, any discussion of General Canby would not be complete without what I regard to be probably the worst military decision in history. Now, this takes place, rather unfortunate story, in the early days of the Civil War. Canby was in New Mexico in the early days of the Civil War, and his job was to hold off a small Confederate army coming in from Texas, interested in trying to get as much New Mexico gold and copper and silver as they could find. So this Confederate army is in New Mexico. Canby's keeping an eye on it. He never really brought it to battle, but he's going to make sure that they don't cause too much trouble. So the scene is set this way. A Union camp is here, maybe about 3,000 or 4,000 soldiers under Canby. Confederates are over here. Camps are pretty close. Nobody's fighting. And these two Union soldiers had an idea about how to get at the Confederates. "Why don't we," they said, and follow along with me, see if you can see the weakness in this scheme. "Why don't we take a couple live howitzer shells, maybe four of them, and strap them onto two mules. So one mule will have two shells, other mule will have another shell. And what we'll do is we'll lead the mules to the sentry line where the Confederate camp begins, and then we'll light the shells on the mules and then kick them on the backside so they run into the Confederate camp and blow a bunch of people up." Now, this is not a good idea. To anybody who's ever been around a mule, it's not a good idea to predict what they're going to do. So here's what happened. These two guys, everything worked like a charm until they got right up to the sentry line and they lit the shells and they slapped the mules on the backside. And the mules just went like this and they turned around towards the Union side and they blew up. And these two guys were showered with bits of mule. So the story ends badly for the mules. But it didn't really kill anybody, as it turned out. Canby was not responsible for that silly, stupid decision. And he was able to do his job fairly well in New Mexico. And that's how he got his job in Alabama towards the end of the war. And he was still in the service of the Army in April of 1873, where we find him determined to negotiate with Captain Jack and maybe put an end to this. But the only way he was going to be able to put an end to it was to persuade the MODOKs to go back to the reservation, where they did not want to go. And the war party was dead set against it. So the scene is in the MODOK camp. It's April of 1873. They've been in the stronghold now for several months. And the war party finally agreed that Captain Jack could go negotiate. But the idea was, the only condition was, that Captain Jack kill General Canby. If General Canby would not agree, Captain Jack was supposed to kill him. This was not something Captain Jack particularly wanted to do, but the only way that he could get any agreement at all, apparently, for any negotiation was to do so on these terms. Give General Canby a chance. If he says no, kill him. It's now April 11th, 1873. Captain Jack said to his fellow Modocs, I will ask him many times, and if it comes to my terms, he will live. If not, I will kill him. I am your chief, he said. I am a Modoc, and it shall be done if it costs every drop of blood in my heart. A Modoc woman named Toby, we can now go to the next slide, Toby Riddle, who had been going back and forth from the army camp to the stronghold. Oh, we'll keep that up there for a second. She very much feared that something was in the offing, that maybe General Canby was in danger. And she pled with him not to go to this negotiation. But Canby told her, don't worry, Sister Toby. The Modocs will not hurt us, General Canby said. God will not allow it. Now, Canby was pretty confident. He had about 500 men. He knew he outnumbered the Modocs 10 to 1. He figured the Modocs will have to surrender. He thought this might be a way to get them to do so. So he was willing to go meet them with just a few men accompanying him. The idea was there'd be five Modocs, maybe five members of the army in their accompanying officials. So the morning comes, Canby's about to go to the meeting. Off he went, accompanied by only a few others, as I said. Toby would go with him. She was in tears on horseback behind him, very much fearing what was about to come. But she might be needed as an interpreter, so she was going to go with him. She spoke both languages. And one of the peace commissioners that went with General Canby was a guy named Alfred Meacham. And Alfred Meacham knew the Modocs very well. He also feared something was up. He also feared that maybe the war party, the only way they would ever allow this meeting is if they were going to kill Canby. He thought so too. So that morning, Alfred Meacham, before setting off with General Canby to this meeting, sat down and wrote a letter to his wife, which he thought would be his last letter. The letter went like this. Dear wife, you may be a widow tonight, but you shall not be a coward's wife. I am not to blame what will happen. He took out all the money he could find. Here is $650, all I have. Yours to the end, Alfred. And then he got on the horse, and together they went out to meet the Modocs. Now, when they got to the assigned meeting place, there was Captain Jack, four or five other Modocs with him. They all sat around a campfire, and Canby, who loves cigars, remember, offered Hungry Jack, Captain Jack, some cigars. And Captain Jack, looking really nervous, said that all they wanted was their land back at the Lost River. If we could have our land back at the Lost River, we'll leave the stronghold. We don't have to come here again. That's all we want. But Canby answered truthfully, I have no authority to give you a new reservation. There's one reservation. That's where the Klamaths are. That's where you've got to go. I have no authority to create a new reservation for you. He didn't lie. He didn't try to trick Captain Jack. He told him the truth. I can't do that. Then Captain Jack said, well, if the army leaves, if he would just leave, let us alone for a while, I'll see if I can persuade everybody to go back. But that also was something General Canby had no authority to do. He's going to keep his army right there, and that's what he told Captain Jack. I can't do that. And at that point, Captain Jack suddenly stood up and said, I've got to relieve myself. And then, when he said that, two Modocs, who had then been up to then had been concealed, suddenly rushed into the meeting site with rifles. What does this mean? Shouted Alfred Meacham, a man who tended to sympathize with the Modocs. What does this mean? Captain Jack, what does this mean? Captain Jack only spun around, drew his revolver, and opened fire. And from 3 feet away, shot General Canby in the left eye. Oh, that didn't kill him. This is Canby trying to get away. It didn't kill him. He ran several yards before other Modocs tackled him and put an end to him. And this is where a Modoc named Boston Charlie enters our story. And he was called Boston Charlie simply because he was rather pale and reminded some of the miners of somebody from Boston, what a Bostonian might look like. And it was Boston Charlie who tried to kill Alfred Meacham, the Indian agent who had written that last note to his wife. and he would have killed Meacham, put a bullet in him, began beating him, very, very seriously hurt Meacham, probably would have died, except at the last minute, Toby, watching Boston Charlie in the process of killing Meacham, began yelling, "The soldiers are coming! The soldiers are coming!" And at that, the MODOCs left and went back to the stronghold, not wanting to be overcome by a group of soldiers from Canby's camp. Now, we don't know how much of that is actually true. Toby, now we'll go to the next slide. This is Toby. Toby has long been known as the Pocahontas of the West because she saved Alfred Meacham by yelling, "The soldiers are coming! The soldiers are coming!" Well, did she really do that? Maybe it was like her to do that, but we don't know because that's the story they told on the lecture circuit later on. Meacham and Toby went on tour together telling this story. Who knows how much of it they cooked up, how much of it actually happened. It might have happened just like they said it is. I don't know. But what we do know is Meacham really was almost killed, almost died right there along with General Canby. When the army did show up, maybe this isn't like an hour later, because nobody's coming home, they got worried. But when the army did show up, they had doctors with them. The doctors looked at Meacham, maybe we can try to save him. They revived him, they're gonna do some really painful first aid on him, but they gotta ask him some questions first. But they revived him, and then they said, "Okay, we're gonna go to work on you, here's some brandy." And Meacham said, "Get that away from me, you fool! I'm a temperance man." And the doctor said, "No, you're not. Stop this nonsense. This is no time for temperance." Made him take the brandy. And that was the first and only time in Meacham's life that any alcohol ever crossed his lips. He finally took it. But he did survive. Like I said, he did one on a lecture tour. Now, Canby, however, could not be saved. He was dead. He was the only general to be killed in the long history of the Indian Wars. And in fact, it's the highest ranking officer in the U.S. Army to die between the Civil War and World War II. Several generals died in combat in World War II, but not in World War I, as far as I know. And not surprisingly, Canby's death caused consternation and rage throughout the country. How dare the MODOCs kill a man in the process of negotiation? You can see the anger that arose all over the country, especially in the West over this. As one newspaper called it, "Captain Jack is guilty, quote, of a crime so unhuman, so deliberate, so utterly wanton and base that death is the only proper remedy." The stronghold now had to be taken at all costs. And to do that, General Sherman, ranking commander of the U.S. Army, decided to send the most ruthless commander he could think of out there to destroy the stronghold and take the MODOCs back to the reservation, and if necessary, hang Captain Jack, Boston Charlie, and the rest. So the man he sent out there is the next guy, the next slide, and that is the unfortunately named, because he was a Civil War general, Jefferson Davis. That is actually Jefferson Davis, not the Mississippi Jefferson Davis, of course. That is the Indiana Jefferson Davis, who was also in the Seminole Wars. That's also where he began his military career. But as of the Civil War, we find him in his 40s or so, having achieved general's rank, at least for the time being. And unfortunately, in 1862, he fell on the wrong side of his immediate commanding officer. Some of you know the story, a guy named General Bull Nelson. Called Bull because there was 300 pounds of him. He's a very large fellow. Now, Nelson was from Kentucky, and Nelson hated all Indianans. And he seems to have transferred this hatred of Indiana to poor Jefferson Davis, because one day he berated Davis, his inferior in rank, in front of a bunch of Davis's men. And Davis was really upset by that. He embarrassed him in front of his men. So Davis went to see the governor of Indiana to see if anything could be done about this General Nelson and the insult that Davis had suffered. And it just so happened that Davis was conferring with with Governor Morton of Indiana at the Galt Hotel in Louisville, Kentucky, when who should walk in the lobby at the same time but Bull Nelson. Davis saw Nelson walk in, demanded an apology from him for what he had said. Instead of apologizing, Nelson slapped Davis across the face. Davis then retreated to a nearby stairway, borrowed a pistol from his friend there, went up closer to Nelson, and called out to him. Nelson turned around, saw Davis with a pistol, shouted at Davis, "You're a coward, sir!" At which point, Davis shot Nelson dead through the heart. One general had killed another general here at the Galt Hotel in Louisville, but Davis was not punished for it. It was considered to be an action that showed his pluck and his self-respect as an officer. So he suffered no penalty for this, nor did he suffer any penalty for a much worse action that occurred during Sherman's March to the Sea in the fall of 1864, when Davis was leading a division. They crossed the rain-swollen Ebenezer Creek on the way to Savannah. The entire division crossed, but they left behind them 100 escaped slaves who the division was supposed to be protecting. Rather than let the slaves cross, Davis ordered the pontoon bridge across the creek to be destroyed before the slaves could cross. Every other division in Sherman's army preserved the slaves who were with them from recapture during that difficult advance on Savannah, not Davis's division. Those slaves died either crossing Ebenezer Creek, or they were recaptured by Confederates under General Wheeler to suffer an unknown but not good fate. He didn't pay any penalty for that either, destroying the pontoon bridge before he had to. But there was that ruthlessness that might have appealed to Sherman now that it was time to win the Modoc War once and for all. As it happened, however, Davis had to get all the way out to California from Indiana. It was going to take him a while to do that. And Canby's men, still at the stronghold, were insistent upon finishing the war before Davis could show up. So not long after the first battle of the stronghold was January, the death of Canby was April. A couple weeks after Canby's death, the army attacked again, the second battle of the stronghold. It's a difficult, remorseless fight. And in the middle of it, the army began to make some headway, began to penetrate ever further into the stronghold. And at that point, Captain Jack and the rest figured it's only a matter of time. There are only less than 50 warriors fighting, after all, behind those rocks. So they decided to split up. They had secret ways out of the stronghold, and they began to leave to preserve themselves in the women and children from the advancing soldiers. Actually, almost all of them got out. And it was now going to be a manhunt. Everybody's trying to find where Captain Jack has gone, Boston Charlie and the rest of them. It took 6 weeks, 2 months, but they eventually tracked down almost all of them. In Captain Jack's case, he was captured deep in the lava beds. They found the cave where he was hiding. The soldiers went in. Captain Jack surrendered. He said, "My legs are too weak to carry me any further." And so he gave up, along with Boston Charlie and others who are going to be blamed for the death of General Canby. That was early June, probably the official end of the Modoc War, the capture of Captain Jack. So the war had cost $500,000 between November and June. If all the army wanted was to undertake a study of the value of the Lost River land, that was about $10,000. They spent $500,000 to preserve $10,000 worth of land up in the Lost River for a white settlement. But now the war was over, and I bet you know what the question now is going to be. What do we do with Captain Jack? Now, Captain Jack had killed Canby during negotiations. So Jefferson Davis, who by now had arrived in the lava beds, wanted simply to kill Captain Jack, kill him right away, along with Boston Charlie, who tried to kill Alfred Meacham. And he would have done so had it not been for the Attorney General of the United States, a friend of Grant's named George Henry Williams. And George Henry Williams believed in the rule of law. He had tracked down the Ku Klux Klan in South Carolina, put an end to them for the time being in the early 1870s. And we owe him a bit of debt of gratitude. Those of you who have traveled to the Pacific Northwest, you may have at one point or another gone to the San Juan Islands, close to the border with Canada. They're American territory because of George Henry Williams. The British wanted it, we wanted it. Williams' idea was, well, we want it, you want it. If that's true, who is the best person in the world to decide who gets the San Juan Islands? And the answer was, obviously, you're thinking the same thing, Kaiser Wilhelm of Germany. So they had an arbitration, and Kaiser Wilhelm said, "I think it should be American," and that's why we have the San Juan Islands. And he was also, Williams was a former Oregonian, so he took a personal interest in Captain Jack and those around him. And Williams said to General Davis, "You can't just kill these offenders who you blame for the murder of General Canby." This was wartime. There was a war going on. The most they can be charged with is a war crime. And if you're going to charge them with a war crime in the killing of General Canby, you've got to put them on trial before a military commission. So that's what was going to happen. The one and only time during the wars of the late 19th century that Native Americans were put on trial before a military commission. That was going to be Captain Jack, Boston Charlie, and the rest. So there's going to be a trial. And you're thinking to yourself the same thing Captain Jack was thinking. Wait a minute. You're charging me with a war crime. I killed the general. Yes, we were supposed to be negotiating. How come you never charge yourselves with war crimes? You kill women and children repeatedly in these wars, but there was never any military commission that was punishing American officers for giving orders like that. Captain Jack and everybody else knew all about the Sand Creek Massacre just 9 years before 1873, when U.S. Army Colonel Samuel Chivington, a lay Methodist preacher, led his cavalry in an attack upon Black Kettle's Cheyenne and Arapaho camp on Sand Creek in Colorado, in which at least 100 women and children were killed. 100. At a time when a flag of truce was flying over that camp along with the American flag. Congress itself said that was an atrocity and recommended that for the honor of the nation, Chivington had to be punished for it. But he never was. The Army never punished Chivington for murdering women and children at Sand Creek. And in fact, one of the men who gave evidence against Chivington before Congress was courageous enough to say what had happened. And in fact, he had ordered his soldiers at Sand Creek not to fire on women and children. This guy was murdered as soon as he got back to Colorado for what he had said. Captain Jack could rightly point out that if the Army was going to punish someone who killed women and children, if the Army was not going to do that, then what were they doing punishing him for killing somebody who actually was in uniform at the time? As he said himself, this is his quote during his trial, "If the white men that killed our women and children had been tried and punished, I would not have thought so much of myself. Do we Indians stand any show for justice with you white people, with your own laws? I say no, I know it. You people can shoot any Indians anytime you want, whether we are at peace or war. I charge the white people with wholesale murder." That's the words of Captain Jack. And he had a point, but who knew if the court would listen? So now let's go to the next slide. These are the defendants in the trial. These are the MODOC defendants, and that is Captain Jack in the middle. The figure on the upper left is Boston Charlie. Back to California, Oregon actually, Fort Klamath, which is where the trial was. So our question is, what's going to happen to these defendants? Well, see, there's a bunch of defendants. Only four, however, were convicted and given the death penalty. So four of the MODOCs were now going to be hanged. The military court didn't listen to this defense. I think they knew that General Sherman expected a guilty verdict and expected the MODOCs to be hanged. Others were going to be sent to Alcatraz for a while, but four were going to be hanged. And the hangings were set for October of 1873. So shortly before the hangings, shortly before Captain Jack was about to die, along with Boston Charlie and two others, their families were given a chance to visit them. They sat almost without speaking for a long time, hugging, maybe wordlessly exchanging goodbyes. And then the time came for the execution. And this was a very fearsome thing for the MODOCs because in their tradition, if you were hanged so that you couldn't breathe when you died, that meant that your spirit couldn't go out through the air in your body, and it couldn't be taken up by other spirits and live a different kind of life in a different realm. So to be killed by hanging was a terrible thing for them, but that was what Captain Jack was now faced with. A great crowd watched. It was a huge crowd watching the hangings, despite what must have been a petrifying thing for them. They faced death with dignity, and as the ropes were put around their necks, they didn't exclaim. They accepted their fate as best they could, and they indeed, four of them were hanged. In October of 1873. The heads were taken off their bodies and transported to Washington, D.C., where the Army Medical Corps took possession of them. They were doing a study of Indian skulls, and they had hundreds of these skulls, so they took the four skulls into possession, and they kept them for about 100 years. And eventually, they were repatriated under American statute. But for a while, people who wanted to could actually see Captain Jack's skull in Washington, D.C. Now, some of the other MODOCs, as I said, some of the other defendants were at Alcatraz for a while, but as far as the women and children, most of the other warriors, they were taken from where they were captured in Northern California, and all of them were transported to Oklahoma, where they would live among the Shawnees in what was then the territory of Oklahoma. They did their best to make a go of it in Oklahoma. They missed Tule Lake very much. They suffered terrible depression from homesickness, and that left them probably weaker when they were struck by pneumonia, tuberculosis, malaria. Many of them began to die. They were the victim of corruption by the agents who were supposed to be feeding them. 130 of them went to Oklahoma by 1874. Only six of them were left by 1879. And among them was Curly-Headed Doctor. Curly-Headed Doctor survived longer than a lot of them did. And he told them shortly before he died that you'll know when my soul is gone because you'll see vast flocks of birds right above me. He died, and sure enough, there were vast flocks of birds, black birds, right above him at the moment of his death. So six Modocs survived, but they are the ancestors of all the modern Modocs of Oklahoma. So today, there are about 200 Modocs in Oklahoma. They live by various means. One thing they do is they sell buffalo meat. They have a buffalo herd, and they sell the meat. So they're still in Oklahoma. And there's about 600 Modocs who are still in southern Oregon. They don't live around the Lost River. They live among the Klamaths. They don't have a reservation anymore, but they live in the same neighborhood as the Klamaths now. So there are about as many Modocs today as there probably were in 1870, a little bit less than 1,000. But like I said, they don't live near the Lost River. The Lost River is no longer the source of wildlife that it was when the Modocs were living off it. It became the victim of some ill-conceived irrigation projects. So there's not much life in the Lost River. And Tule Lake is about one-fifth the size that it used to be. Too much of it has been used for agriculture and mismanaged, which is why it's so shallow and small now. But if anybody has ever heard of Tule Lake, the reason people know Tule Lake is that was the Japanese internment camp where the no-nos were sent. So if you were a real resistor to what the government was doing to you in those internment camps, if you were a male, you'd answer question 27 on the form everybody was given if they were male. Will you fight for United States Armed Forces? No. Do you accept U.S. citizenship? I think that's the next, or no. So that's called a no-no. And the no-nos were sent to Tule Lake. They were considered the hard cases. Tule Lake is also where George Takei, Mr. Sulu from Star Trek, that's where his family was kept during Japanese internment at Tule Lake. So they were outcasts among outcasts. Sometimes they refused to work when ordered to, protesting what was happening to them. But also at Tule Lake during World War II, there were about 800 German POWs who, unlike the Japanese Americans, were not confined. They were allowed to go anywhere they wanted around the lake. A strange, sad, and ironic ending to the story of the Modoc War. So now's the time for anybody who wants to have some refreshments, brownies, coffee, cider, stretch if you want to. And then maybe we can take some comments in a few minutes after that. So thank you. But I'll do what I can to help if anybody would like to ask something. Yes?
Where was the trial held and the hanging held?
Fort Klamath, which is in Oregon, north of Tule Lake. That was the base of operations during most of the war, is Fort Klamath.
Could we go back to the map?
Oh, yeah, maybe we can go back to the map. If I've got the location right, I'll show you. This probably won't tell us because that's a modern map, but this is Merrill. I think Fort Klamath was north of Merrill, like about there. I think that's where it was.
Now, is that in California or not?
Oregon, yeah.
Is that with relation to a place like Everett?
Olesa, so it's way south of there, south. Yeah. Anybody else? Yes. Go ahead.
Ever hopeful. All these years later, mm-hmm. California or the United States ever paid reparations to the Modocs?
I should find that out. The question is, has there been any reparations paid to the Modocs? The Seminoles, for example, did get some reparations, but what about the Modocs? I don't know. That would be an easy thing to look up, though. So if I remember, I will, and we could talk about that in a couple weeks, but that'd be a really good thing to know. I know they get some federal support in Oklahoma, but I don't know about reparations. Yes?
Well, this is on something else. My father worked construction in New York, and there were quite a number of Mohawk, working. Mm-hmm. They always said because they could walk across, really up high, mm-hmm. and it was in their blood. And one of them told my father, he said, if the dumb whites want to think that they couldn't care less. Mm-hmm. They made good wages, they're off the damn reservation. He said, they want to think it.
Yeah,
just laugh.
The whole thing about things being in your blood has been a very harmful idea.
He said you got used to it.
Uh-huh.
That was it.
Yeah, I don't think I would, but go ahead. Yeah.
My American history has faded more than a bit. When did California, Washington, and Oregon become states?
California was 1850, and Oregon was right on the eve of the Civil War. They became a state. In Washington a little bit later. I think. Maybe about the same time. I think Oregon and Washington might have become states in the 1860s, I think. 1859. Close. 1859. Yeah, okay. 1889. Washington? Well, Oregon was before Washington, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, 18 that late? 1889? Washington? Okay.
Yeah, Oregon joined the same year. North, South Dakota, Montana.
All right. Okay, very good. I'm glad you're here. Thank you. Okay. Yeah, because Oregon had some regiments in the Civil War. They were state regiments. Yes, go ahead.
Somebody saw me looking this up, and I just looked up who killed John Wilkes Booth, and according to Wikipedia and a couple of other sources, it was Union soldier Boston Corbett, C-O-R-B-E-T-T.
Oh, what was his nickname, Boston Charlie? But Boston Corbett.
Didn't say in the article.
Okay. Well, if anybody can trace this Walt Kelly Pogo story to Boston Charlie, I'd be interested to know that. But because that was the first thing I thought of when I read about Boston Charlie. Maybe Walt Kelly knew that, but we have no idea.
More likely Boston Charlie on the MTA.
Yeah.
Yeah, maybe. One thing I forgot to mention last week was I told you that so many Seminoles went to Oklahoma, and they were there, of course, during the Comanche Wars, which is right after. Right, in fact, during the height of the Modoc War, and three of the Seminoles got the Medal of Honor as scouts for the U.S. Army, putting themselves in grave danger during the Comanche Wars. So since I mentioned Major Green getting the Medal of Honor, I thought of that too. I should probably mention that. Yes?
That was the only medal available. And much later on, a lot of people rescinded.
Yeah, and there was no Distinguished Service Cross back then.
That was the only medal.
That was it.
But later on, a lot of them rescinded. I think they went back and checked out. I don't know how many or which ones, but I know that they were rescinded because that was the only thing they gave until they.
Yeah, for a long time. Yeah. Yes?
I had a daughter who's now a doctor who spent 6 weeks at an Apache reservation in Arizona, and she said that the nutrition and the health of those people was such that they most likely would be extinct in her lifetime.
Didn't hear that.
That's among the Apaches?
Yes. My daughter spent 6 weeks at an Apache reservation in Arizona as a medical student. And when she came home, she said that their health and nutrition was such that they most likely would be extinct in her lifetime.
Well, we're going to end with that topic, actually. The wars in the 1880s in Apacheria, the end of the Apache Wars. That'll be the last thing we cover, actually. But in 2 weeks, I'm really looking forward to that because probably the most familiar episode for most people of the wars of the 19th century was the Battle of Little Bighorn. So I'll be talking a bit about so-called Custer's Last Stand in 1876. But I'm really interested in talking about that because of the episode that follows that fewer people know about, one of the most fabled marches of the U.S. Army, the famous Horse Meat March. And I'll be talking about that as well. Now, as far as the MODOCs go, I don't know if anybody perhaps knows something about this topic, if they want to raise something else that I didn't cover, or if anybody had any questions about it. Now might be the time to do it. Yes?
Said on Google that was the costliest of all the Indian wars.
Well, I wouldn't be surprised. $500,000 for less than 6 months. And $500,000 in 1873 money. Too. That's vastly expensive. Right.
But it probably isn't real money. In other words, there were soldiers who were going to be somewhere, someplace, anyway. And since they were out there, they probably just counted that salary.
And they had to keep them in one place for a long time. They had to supply them there, which over a very difficult country, had to pay a bunch of people probably to do it. Yeah, it could not have been easy.
They had to pay them if they were someplace else, too.
Well, but if they were at Fort Klamath, it would have been easier. They would have had a regular line, right? So,
maybe.
Yeah. Anybody else? Yes, go ahead.
Just a quick observation.
Go ahead.
I've been part of a Civil War reading group, and one thing that I was struck in that is how all of these generals from the Civil War and all this were all buddies that had been at West Point, and a lot of them wind up out here. Are we going to talk about Sheridan at some point?
Oh, we'll mention him because he was heavily involved in the planning that led to Little Bighorn. So I'll mention him in a couple weeks. Yeah, Sheridan and Sherman, both Sherman especially in the Southern Plains, but eventually he was, and his headquarters was in New York, but he was commanding the entire army. So like I said, he was involved here with these orders. But we'll mention Sheridan.
Grant was stationed up...
Well, before the Civil War, he was stationed in the Northwest, yeah.
That's right, it was mm-hmm. Port Vancouver, whatever.
Yeah, well, that's where he got into trouble with alcohol, right?
Right.
Because he was away from Julia. Mm-hmm. And that was the besetting sin of all these guys in the Army out West. There's a lot of loneliness, a lot of boredom for much of their time, and they too often took to drink. So I could talk a bit about that. That was a very, very difficult, underpaid life for a lot of them. So that might be something we can go into next time. Yeah?
Nothing has changed.
Nothing has changed. Maybe a little better now, I hope. There's no GI Bill back then. So it's not as if they had an education. Most of them didn't last more than a few years in the uniform. A lot of them deserted, just left. Went to the gold fields, went to the copper mines, anything they could do. Yeah?
Will you cover the overall picture, the federal policy, and how that developed to, as an overarching strategy of how to deal with the Indians?
Yeah, so I'll summarize the peace policy again, which was all about this ideal of well-run reservations that broke down in practice, maybe not surprisingly, and resulted in especially the Sioux deciding they wanted nothing to do with reservation life, which gave us Little Bighorn. So we'll talk about that, and also what followed it. So yeah, I'll try to put it in the big picture next time.
Good.
Yes?
Yeah, the Removal Act, from the, say, the Southeast Indians and the Northwest, the Northeast Indians, like in Ohio.
Yeah.
And they take these people, this is forest, free land, and they take them to Oklahoma, where, as I think is more open and free, they probably could not adapt.
Well, yeah, so that the point is that so many of the Eastern Indians were sent to Oklahoma, and then we just saw the Modocs were sent to Oklahoma, and the only way they could possibly adapt was with a lot of federal help, which they often didn't get. What they did get was help from other native peoples who were already there. Sometimes there was bad blood between them, but often they would pitch in and they would help. And to the extent that some were able to survive under difficult conditions like the Modocs, that's part of the reason. And they had help from others who spoke very different languages, totally different traditions, but understood the predicament they were in. And some of the Apaches went to Oklahoma. So yeah, we'll talk about that as well.
So yeah. The current Portland, Oregon.
Yes.
What tribe is there?
She's in Oklahoma.
By Portland? I'm not sure, but that's a little bit north for the Klamaths, and a little bit south for the Squamish and peoples like that around Seattle. So who would be around the Columbia River? We'll have to look into that too.
Did you get that from Lewis and Clark?
Yeah. Oh yeah. That's right. So they're a little bit to the west of the Shoshone. That would be, I just saw on the tip of my tongue. Who are they? Because Lewis and Clark had a lot to do with them. I've got to look into that. Because I forget now. So I have a lot to look up now. So I will. I will, I promise.
Their whole party was very unhappy because all they had to eat was salmon. And they wanted red meat.
Yeah, you would probably get tired of that after a while. Yeah. Yes, go ahead.
There's something for you to look up if you're looking.
Okay, what else can I look up?
Who designed the decorations on that Canby and Jefferson Davis? These are soldiers theoretically going to war.
Uh-huh.
18 buttons on the front of their clothes.
Yeah. Well, it's a very good point. I guess you could argue those are dress uniforms. They wouldn't be in combat in those.
Well, I know, but even if one pops up...
Yeah, you would... I would agree it's totally impractical. Yes? Yes, and there's Davis. Yeah. Yeah. Very good point. Yeah. Now, maybe easier to find out about the Columbia Valley than these buttons. Well, at any rate, we will reconvene in a couple weeks. And we'll talk about the campaign in the Dakotas in Montana. So I'll see you then. Thank you.
I'm about to hold you on that question.
Okay. We'll do. Looking forward to it. Yes.
I thought you made a good point. I remember when the Navy diverted some ships to try to...